repeating the yesterday's lecture. So at the end of the lecture, if you have queries, you can ask. But up to the end, you must listen carefully because I will not share my slides and you take pics from there. But you can ask me questions. So you have my mobile number, you have my WhatsApp number. You can ask me by my WhatsApp contact. So let's start. Again, as you know, that we have started yesterday, we have started the extracellular matrix. ECM1 was the yesterday's lecture. I'm repeating it. The fibrous element collagen was discussed in detail. As I have told you that this is the most early, most abundant protein found in mammals, found in the extracellular matrix, very important protein, extracellular protein, that is the collagen that we will discuss, its composition and its synthesis along with their clinical correlation. So let's start the learning objectives that are that a student that must understand at the end of the lecture. They should be able to know the composition of the extracellular matrix, the composition of the cartilage, the chemical structure of collagen, its synthesis, and its clinical correlation with the deficiency of the vitamin C that has got the important role in one of the reaction of the biosynthesis of the collagen. Whereas at the end, we will discuss, inshallah, the deficiency of vitamin C scurvy that can lead to the, its deficiency can lead to the decreased synthesis of the collagen molecule. So let's start. The extracellular matrix that is supporting tissues found outside the cell, that is considered as a basic unit of the life. The tissues are made up of the cells, and the tissues outside the cell, they contain a ground substance, a substance that has got certain fibers in its structure. These are shown in this picture that these fibers, they may be in the form of the elastin, they are in the form of the collagen fibers, the elastin fibers, and you can see over here certain proteoglycans are also there. Certain other smaller proteins are also found in the smaller amounts. Some of them are in very large structure. These are called as the laminin, the fibrillin, and fibronectin. The other proteins found in the extracellular compartment or in the extracellular matrix, other than the collagen and the elastin. The two main important proteins of the extracellular matrix are the fibers are of the elastin and collagen that we will discuss in detail, but we will touch the other proteins through the simpler discussion. Each of these proteins, they will be discussed in a single slide for the fibronectin in ECM2, for the laminin, and for the fibrillin. So the major proteins are the collagen and elastin. The extracellular matrix has got the two specialized forms of the tissues. These are called as a bone and the cartilage. Extracellular matrix contain the three major classes of the biomolecules. Certain are the proteins and others are the protein that contain the, it contain the carbohydrates. These are called as the proteoglycans are the glycosaminoglycans. Okay, so proteoglycans are glycoproteins, the proteins that are associated with the carbohydrates. Formerly, previously, they were called as the mucopolysaccharides because of the slippery physical properties of the glycosaminoglycans that are found in the different tissues of the extracellular matrix, in the synovial joints, in the cells that contain the heteropolysaccharides. They contain heteropolysaccharides. And these are called as the GAGs. For example, if you are familiar of that certain names of the glycosaminoglycans are GAGs. These are heparin, heparin sulfate, keratin, keratin sulfate, chondroitin sulfate. These are all called as the GAGs that will be discussed, inshallah, by Dr. Beenish after my completion of my lectures regarding the extracellular matrix, ECM1 and 2. After that, you will be discussed for the glycosaminoglycans or the proteoglycans. These are also called as a mucopolysaccharides, the slippery heteropolysaccharide containing molecules that contain proteins along with it, the carbohydrates, collectively called as a proteoglycan. So proteins, they are found in the extracellular matrix. Certain are structural proteins and certain are the specialized proteins. The examples are given in front of the names of these structural and specialized protein, collagen, elastin, and the fibrillin. These are the structural proteins, and certain specialized proteins, as I was telling you, these are the fibrillin, fibronectin, and laminin that will be discussed in ECM2 lecture, inshallah. Today I will finish it. So let's see first the cartilage. Generally, cartilages, these are called as the supporting flexible connective tissue. Cartilage, if in the layman language, you can say that it is a flexible type of the bones that are found in the nose, that are found in the ear, and these are called as the flexible hard tissues, and they give the support. They are called as the supporting connective tissues. The main cell type that produce them, the cartilage, these are called as the chondrocytes. These are avascular. Cartilages are avascular. They do not have the blood vessels, but they get their nutrition from the synovial fluid. They exhibit the slow but continuous turnover. Once they are damaged, but they can be continuously turned over, but slowly. The three types of the cartilages are found. Number one, hyaline cartilage. It contains type 2 collagen. Collagen, yesterday I told you there are the 19 well-known types of the collagen are there, but more than 19, up to 29 types of the collagen are found. This is a new research. New research tells that there are more than 19 types of the collagen are found, up to the 29 or up to the 30 types of the collagen are there. But here in our books, we are very well discussed with the 19 types of the collagen that are written in the older Harper books, and in the newer Harper books, they are explaining the 19 different types of the collagen. So type 2 collagen is present in hyaline cartilage. The second type of cartilage is fibrous. Third one is called as the elastin cartilage. That elastin cartilage is found in the elastic, fibroelastic or cartilage. The composition of the cartilage is that it is composed of the proteoglycans. As I was telling you, the proteoglycans are also called as the GAGs, glycosaminoglycans. GAGs means glycosaminoglycans. Glycosaminoglycans are those heteropolysaccharides that contain the core protein along with it. That's why these are called the proteo means protein and glycans means carbohydrates. So this is a complex proteins, complex or compound proteins. So these are called as the proteoglycans. The proteoglycan found, the major proteoglycan found in the cartilage, it is called as a agrecan. Agrecan is a major proteoglycan of the cartilage. Remember, these are very important points, important questions for your BCQs. The cartilage that contain the major proteoglycan, it is called as the agrecan. This agrecan contains the hyaluronic acid and chondroitin sulfate and the keratin sulfate. So the proteoglycans of the cartilages, these are three in number. So they have got the three domains. Proteoglycans have the three domains A, B, C for the GAGs are for the proteoglycans. For agrecan, these three domains A, B, C, they are referred with the core proteins. So these are hyaluronic acid, chondroitin sulfate, and keratin sulfate, the proteoglycans of the cartilage. The next is the collagen proteins. Collagen proteins found in the cartilage, these are mainly type 2. So type 2 is the principal collagen found in the cartilage. This is comprising the 90 to 98% of the total collagen proteins. The other collagen proteins, they may be type 5, 6, 9, 10, and 11. After that, collagen proteins, certain non-collagen proteins are also found. These are called as the dermatan sulfate, proteoglycan 1, dermatan sulfate, proteoglycan 2, chondroinectin, and ancorin C2 that resemble with the chondroitin sulfate 1 and 2. So chondroitin sulfate that resembles with the dermatan sulfate is actually the non-collagen protein found in the cartilage. So you must memorize. I know that this is very difficult to memorize these small points are the different names of these difficult proteins and non-protein parts of these extracellular matrix components. So this is hard to memorize, but you have to memorize. So remember, what are the collagen proteins of the cartilage? These are type 2 collagen proteins. Type 2 collagen protein, 90 to 98%. The proteoglycans of the cartilage, they are glycosaminoglycans, including the hyaluronic acid, chondroitin sulfate, and keratin sulfate. Non-collagen proteins are dermatan sulfate, proteoglycan 1, dermatan sulfate, proteoglycan 2, chondroinectin, and ancorin C2. Connective tissue. So at the end, you come to know that connective tissue is composed of the two main components. Number one, it is the fibers of the connective tissue. The fibrous elements, these are collagen and elastin fibers. And other than the fibrous element, there is a ground substance. Over there, the fibrous elements are found. So proteoglycans, they are actually forming a mesh ground substance. Proteoglycans, small molecules of the proteoglycans. If you remember the structure of the extracellular matrix, in my first slide I have shown you, there was a proteoglycans making the ground substance, and in the ground substance certain and fibrous elements or fibrous proteins were there that were including the collagen, elastin, and the third one is the fibrillin, fibronectin, and elastin fibers. So in this way, there is a two main parts of the connective tissues, fibrous and the ground substance. Now the chemical structure of the collagen, it is collagen, as it is the most abundant protein of the mammals. The principal structure of the collagen is it is the structure element, and the principal collagen is type 1, type 2, and 3 that are mainly the main collagen types found in the human body proteins. So the connective tissues, the collagen found in the tendons, collagen is found in cartilages, in ligaments, in the bones, and in the cornea of eye. There are the 30 different distinct types of the polypeptide chains are there, and that's why, so there are the 30 genes, 30 collagen genes are there that are encoding for the same 30 distinct polypeptide chains. So in cardiovascular system, so 19 types of the collagen they are actually expressed in the different books, in your books, in Lippincott, in Harper. So they are telling about the 19 types, but up to in the research articles, as I have seen, these are beyond the 19 type. They are up to the more than 30 types are of the collagen they are found. So fibrille forming collagen type 1 is found in skin and in bone, type 2 in cartilage, whereas so all of the collagen types, they have the triple helix. Structure of the of the collagen is chemically discussed, that it is made up of the triple helical alpha polypeptide chains. They are twisted with each other, and when they are bonded with each other, they are making a cylindrical structure that is called as a tropocollagen. So tropocollagen it may be defined as the extracellular fibrous protein that contain the three helical polypeptide chains. This is called as the triple helical, are called as a trimer of the polypeptides. So this is a definition of the tropocollagen, or you can say it is a mature collagen that is metabolically active, tropocollagen. The triple helical structure that has got the three helical polypeptide alpha chains. Okay, so triple helical structure is made up of three helical polypeptide alpha polypeptide chains. They are making the rod-like molecule that is called as the tropocollagen. The diameter or thickness of this tropocollagen molecule or mature collagen molecule is about 1.4 to 1.5 nanometer. It is thick, and whereas it is as long as, you must know, it is very, very important, a mature protein formed. Formed whenever the collagen biosynthesis is occurring in the cell. Collagen type 1 has got approximately thousands numbers of the amino acids. Remember, someone was asking me yesterday that how only when proline and hydroxyproline, lysine and hydroxylysine are found, then how the disulfide bridges are found. Now you can see over here, there are the thousands of the numbers of the amino acids found in a single in a type of the collagen. So about 100 of the more than the 100 numbers of the amino acids, they are proline. So, but at the third, every third amino acid is for the proline, hydroxyproline, lysine, and hydroxylysine. So the third molecule, the third residue is for the glycine residue that is found at the third position of the polypeptide chain. Whenever there's a twisting of these three polypeptide chain occur, they are making a mature collagen molecule that is called as a tropocollagen. So for the newcomers, I have started my yesterday's lecture. I'm repeating it. This is the extracellular matrix composed of the different types of proteins, the fibrous proteins, the fibers, elastin, and collagen, and other smaller proteins that are the laminin, fibrillin, and fibronectin that we will end to. So the repeating structure found in the tropocollagen, that is absolute requirement for the collagen molecule. This is called as the glycine X and Y and in number. That these are the repeating structure after every glycine X and Y. Then again, glycine X and Y. So there's a different the arrangement of the amino acids are there, but more than 100 or up to 100 numbers of the X position, they are occupied by proline, okay? And more than 100 are up to the 100 numbers. If we consider that it is a thousand number of the amino acids are there, out of these 1,100 are for the prolines. The X position are for the proline, whereas hundreds of the Y position are for the hydroxyproline. Actually, these two are the amino acid. They are giving the stability to the collagen molecule. So remember, the amino acids that are responsible for the stability for the collagen, these are proline and hydroxyproline. Whereas the Y position can be occupied by the lysine. If it is lysine, it must be hydroxylated through hydroxylysine through the acyl hydroxylase enzyme. So type 4 collagen is discontinuous triple helical structure that is found in the basement membrane. It is actually found that is the best characterized example of the collagen, the type 4 collagen that is continuous triple helical structure. And it is important component of the basement membrane where it forms the mesh-like network. The known glycine X and Y sequence, they do not form the fibrils in the tissues. These are forming the globular structure. Okay? So the globular part that is found formed by the glycine, whereas the known glycine X and Y sequence that are not actually forming the fibers are the fibrils in the tissues. They are globular structure that are making the lollipop-like structure. This is the reaction that is showing the post-translational modification that will be discussed in for the synthesis or biosynthesis of the collagen. Remember, when proline is found at the X position and lysine is found at the Y position, during their signaling sequencing, in the lumen of the endoplasmic reticulum, they are converted into their hydroxyl form. This hydroxyl form of the proline and hydroxyproline is called as a hydroxyproline and the hydroxylysine with the help of prolyl hydroxylase enzyme and lysyl hydroxylase enzyme. These two enzymes that are required for post-translational modifications of the proline and lysine, this modification is called as a hydroxylation of these two amino acids that is catalyzed by the two enzymes, prolyl and lysyl hydroxylases. These two enzymes require the ascorbic acid or vitamin C. Due to the deficiency of ascorbic acid or vitamin C, as you know, that can cause the bleeding gums, that is very, very important. The explanation for the bleeding gums, whenever there's a deficiency of the vitamin C occurs, that leads to the decreased synthesis of the collagen. So a very crucial requirement for the collagen synthesis is the availability of the vitamin C ascorbic acid for the post-translational modification of the two important amino acids required for the synthesis of the mature collagen or collagen molecule. So several tropocollagen molecules, they are parallelly arranged over each other. They are making the microfibrils. When they are characterized with the 67 nanometer spacing of the cross striations. If you see the pictures at the page, at the second page of the extracellular matrix chapter of the Harper, you will see over there that there is a gap found in the longitudinal arranged microfibrils of the tropocollagen molecule or mature collagen molecule. There is a spacing between the longitudinally arranged molecules of the mature collagen molecules. So and that spacing is just less than a quarter length of their length. So less than one quarter of their length, there is a 67 nanometer gaping or of the tropocollagen molecule. This is about the 67 nanometer. This collagen molecule is very strengthful. It is very strong fiber that has the highest tensile strength. A fiber that if you think that it is a 1 millimeter thick, it can bear more than 10 kilogram, that is between the 10 to 40 kilogram before it breaks up, it can bear the weight of the materials. So it is a very tensile molecule. Now you can see this is from the Harper book. You can see I'm showing you the length that I was telling you. That is the 67 nanometer and the longitudinal arrangement, the longitudinal spacing that is shown in this picture. There is a lateral association of these triple helical units into the quarter staggered alignment so that they are displaced longitudinally from each other. So you can see there is a longitudinal spacing from the neighboring the microfibrils. So they are longitudinally arranged with the spacing of the 67 7 nanometer, that is less than the quarter length of the microfibrils. So this is called the quarter staggered alignment. So in this way, if we take one molecule, this is the 300 nanometer long, where its thickness is 1.0. They are of the amino acid repeatedly. There is every third of the amino acid you can see in this arrangement. This is regarding the, this is about the glycine. Why the reason, if someone asks me why, what is the reason why glycine is coming after every third, that is taking its place, taking its position, this is for the glycine, that's why. Now you can see, let's start the synthesis of the collagen molecule. The three polypeptide, alpha polypeptide chains are there. When they are separatedly, then they assemble with each other, the procollagen molecule is synthesized. Generally, I am telling you, then we will discuss in detail. So there's the self-assembly that happens in the nucleus, and after that, the procollagen that is coming in the lumen or in the vascular space of the endoplasmic reticulum, and there's a self-assembly of these three polypeptide chain occurs, and the procollagen is synthesized over there in the lumen of the endoplasmic reticulum. The procollagen is then through the two amino acid peptidases enzymes from the C and N terminal. Procollagen peptidase enzymes are there. They will cleave the are causing the clipping or removal of the ends of the range and centrical structure, a solid, highly tensile cylindrical structure. With this tropocollagen, then from the Golgi apparatus, it is then released into the secretory vesicles. Secretory vesicles and the vesicles in the vesicles, and in this way, and they finally they are then arranged as a tropocollagen. Their self-assembly occurs, and the collagen fibers, they are arranged. You can see there is a spacing, there is a gaping. After that, there is a self-assembly, and there is a cross-linking occurs. That cross-linking, these are the types of the collagens. You take the pics from there and just memorize them. There's no need to explain these types, but you have to see what are the types and where they are found. Okay. The other major types of the collagen, they are explained in this slide. 90% of the collagen, most of the collagen, they are the fibril forming collagen. And they are found in the bones, in the tendons, in ligaments, in cornea, cartilages, vitreous body, in the skin, and in the blood vessels, in lungs, all of the, they are stretchable molecule there. The cartilages are there. They are found over there. The collagen molecule is found over there. I'm going quickly because this is all discussed yesterday. The biosynthesis of the collagen is very complex process that includes so many steps. So it is started from the inside the cell, and this is the sequencing of the amino acid. You know that this is called a transcription. It started from the nucleus, that is ordering the arrangement or the signal sequencing of the amino acid through the transcription. That is then coming out of the nucleus, and in the lumen of the endoplasmic reticulum, there is a synthesis a specialized signal sequence of the amino acid in the ribosomes. And then from the ribosome, in the rough endoplasmic reticulum, the lumen of the rough endoplasmic reticulum, there is a pre-procollagen or pre-pro-alpha chain that are formed. That happens with the help of the fibroblasts cells. These are the polypeptide precursors. First, they are synthesized, and after their preforms are pre-procollagen, procollagen. These are then uniquely post-translated through the hydroxylation and glycosylation events. They are finally converted into the mature collagen. Okay, so these are all events. Now, the steps that are required for the collagen synthesis, number one, there is a synthesis of the precursor for the polypeptide chains. The precursor for the polypeptide chains are called as the pre-pro-alpha chain or pro-alpha chain. Then the pro-alpha chain converted into pro-collagen, pro-collagen into the tropocollagen. So these are all the steps that are, I have taken these steps from the another book that is the Dinesh Puri. So from Dinesh Puri, these steps are from there, whereas I will show you the different other steps from the Harper, but you must read from Harper. Do not read from Dinesh Puri. Because I have briefly taken the very important points from there. Do not take or refer the Dinesh Puri. Just read my slides. That will be more than enough for you along with the Harper book. So number one step, these are the general steps for the biosynthesis of the collagen. Number one is the formation of the precursor polypeptide chains. Then the post-translational modifications occur. Then there's the chain assembly. Then there is a chain assembly. After chain assembly, there's a proteolysis from the two terminal, C terminal and the N terminal ends of the tropocollagen. Then the collagen fibrils and the fibers mature tropocollagen is formed. Then after the maturity of the collagen fibers, finally there is a cross-linking by the two processes. Number one is the shift-based formation and number two is the aldol condensation. So the two covalent cross-linking occurs with the fibers of the collagen. These are two types. These are of the two types: shift-based formation and the aldol condensation. These are two cross-linking in the collagen fibers formation that strengthen the collagen molecule. So that was that I was telling you the steps of the collagen synthesis written in your Harper book, that the two main areas where the collagen molecule is synthesized, intracellularly and extracellularly. The step that happens in intracellular collagen synthesis, number one is the cleavage of the signal peptide. After that, when there's a cleavage of the signal peptide, there's a hydroxylation of the proline with the proline, proline residues, hydroxylation of the proline and some of the lysine residues. So after the hydroxylation of the proline and lysine, they are converted into hydroxyproline and hydroxylysine. Hydroxylysine is undergoing the glycosylation. Okay, that glycosylation happens with the help of the two carbohydrates, glucose and galactose. Then there is an interchain and intrachain disulfide bonds are found that are found at the extension or ends of the peptide, polypeptide chains. They are then cutted or cleaved and there's a formation of the triple helix. The triple helix is coming out, and when they are coming out, then the disulfide bonds found at the ends of the extension of the polypeptide chain, they are then cleaved off with the help of the peptidases enzymes. The C terminal and N terminal peptidases enzymes are there that will cut or cleave and these ends, these both ends of the tropocollagen molecule. Then there is assembly of the collagen fibers into the quarter staggered alignment that I was telling you, that is less than the 1/4 length of the tropocollagen molecule. Okay, so and there's the spacing between the collagen molecules, if we look longitudinally. Then there is oxidative deamination of the amino group of the lysine and hydroxylysine. After the oxidative deamination, when oxygen is added and it is deaminated, lysine molecule is converted into the L-isyl carldalz, and that will get the aldehyde functional group. That aldehyde functional group containing lysine molecule is called as L-isyl. Then after L-isyl synthesis, there is a formation of the cross-linking, covalent cross-linking through the shift base and through the aldol condensation. So this is the final step for the collagen biosynthesis. Now, see over here, there's a synthesis of the pre-pro collagen or pre-pro alpha chain with the hydrophobic signal sequencing. There's the removal of the signal sequence by the signal peptidases enzyme. Pro alpha chain is formed. Then there is a hydroxylation of the proline and lysine occurs with the help of the vitamin C. The reaction that is catalyzed by prolyl hydroxylase enzyme and lysyl hydroxylase enzyme at this step, the step for the hydroxylation of proline and lysine. After that, hydroxylysine is glycosylated. This is another post-translational modification. There's a glycosylation of the hydroxylysines, then it is converted into triple helix molecule. That is called as a triple helix formation. After triple helical molecule synthesis, you can see the ends are there that has got the disulfide bridge. You can see SNS, SNS, disulfide bridges between the two polypeptide chains is there. They are coming out of the cell and extracellularly, they are then reacted with the help of enzyme, the peptidases, they are cleaved. These two sites are cleaved. The two sites of the procollagen, they are cleaved, then it is converted into the collagen. This collagen is called as a tropocollagen. This is the cylindrical tropocollagen, mature collagen molecule is then assembled into the fibrils and they are stabilized by the covalent cross linking. That covalent cross linking is catalyzed by enzyme called as a lysyl oxidase. Lysyl oxidase is an enzyme that is copper dependent that causes the conversion of the lysine molecule into lysine residue or lysine amino acid into the lysyl or aldehyde containing lysine amino acid that is catalyzed by lysyl oxidase enzyme that causes the oxidative deamination and there is the synthesis of the shift base formation and the aldol condensation. After that, the mature tropocollagen molecule, they are aggregated and they are forming the fibers of the collagen. Again, it is repeated. It is, you can see there's a transcription and the nucleus through them with the help of lysine, proline, and lysine molecules there. Then there's a hydroxylation of the lysyl hydroxylase and prolyl hydroxylase, vitamin C dependent, and alpha-ketoglutarate is also required for this reaction. Then hydroxyproline and hydroxylysine are synthesized. This is called as a prochain or procollagen that has got a hydroxylysine, hydroxyproline. Then hydroxylysine is glycosylated. Okay, then procollagen is converted, prochain, pro-alpha chain or procollagen is converted into triple helix. Over there, there are the interchain and intrachain disulfide bonds are formed. That happens in the Golgi apparatus and through the secretory vesicles, they are exocytosized into the extracellular space. In extracellular space, there is the cleaving or clipping of the two ends or amino and C-terminal or N-terminal ends of the polypeptide chains. They are then with the help of peptidases enzyme, that is amino proteinase, and carboxyproteinase, these peptidase, the tropocollagen, the quarter staggered alignment, they are forming the fibrils. Then after that, there is oxidative deamination. That oxidative deamination causes the cross-linking between the fibers. And in this way, that is the copper-dependent enzyme, lysyl oxidase. Lysyl oxidase causes the covalent cross-linking. This is called as the shift-based formation and the aldol condensation. In this way, there is a mature tropocollagen molecule synthesized. This is a reaction showing the lysine molecules acted upon by the lysyl oxidase. You can see oxygen is added. That's why it is called as oxidation reaction and the removal of the amino group. So this is the oxidative deamination that happens with the help of enzyme lysyl oxidase, where lysine is converted into a lysine residue. Lysine residue has got the aldehyde group. You can see this is the aldehyde group, C double bond OH. This is called as a lysine residue. Actually, a lysine residue is there that is responsible for the formation of the aldol cross linking. You can see one lysine, other lysine, two lysine molecules. There is oxidative deamination. Lysyl oxidase enzyme is there. Two lysines are converted into a lysine. lysine into a lysine, other lysine into another lysine. There is a aldehyde groups. They are then found in the lysine molecules. You can see amino group is removed at these two ends, and that will get the aldehyde functional group. So aldehyde functional group, they are then condensed and forming the aldol condensation. The lysine molecule, when combined with the lysine residue, that will form the shift base. So this is the main difference between the shift base formation and the aldol condensation. Aldol condensation occurs between the two aldehyde containing lysine molecules or a lysine molecule, whereas the shift base condensation or formation that happens between the lysine residue and lysine residue. In this way, water is out during this, and shift base bonding occurs between the lysine residue of the one polypeptide chain with the lysine residue of the another polypeptide chain, and there is the shift base covalent bonding occur that make the collagen fibers connected with each other. In this way, there is a twisting of the three polypeptide chain occurs with the help of these two cross-linkings, shift-based cross-linking and the aldol condensation. And say these two cross-linking, they stabilize the collagen structure. Once they are formed, collagen molecule become metabolically stable, and there's an increased breakdown of the collagen occur during the starvation, whereas the excessive production of the collagen molecule occurs in the hepatic cirrhosis. Now, the clinical correlation of the collagen. A number of the genetic diseases that result from the abnormalities of the collagen synthesis, the 30 genes that encode for the 30 polypeptide chains that are required for the collagen molecule synthesis, at least 8 enzymes catalyze reactions or post-translational steps that are causing the diseases of the different types of the collagen molecules. Number one disease is called as the osteogenesis imperfecta, or this is imperfecta, not imperfect. This is osteogenesis imperfecta. This is also called the brittle bone syndrome. That brittle bone syndrome is the disease of the type 1 collagen molecule. Over there, there's a repeated fractures occur in the with the long bones of the person. There's a loss of hearing, there's a blue sclera, and there's a poor teeth development due to the deficiency of the type 1 collagen molecule. This disease is called as brittle bone syndrome. Number two disease is called as osteoporosis. Number three is called as Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. This is a disease of the type 4 collagen. Some of these diseases we will discuss in detail. Alport syndrome is the fourth inherited disease, a genetic disease. Epidermolysis bullosa is a disease of the type 7 collagen. Epidermosis bullosa simplex. Scurvy, it is not a genetic disease, but deficiency of the vitamin C that is considered as a cofactor for the enzyme hydroxylase, prolyl hydroxylase and lysyl hydroxylase. Vitamin C is working as a cofactor. Okay, this is a non-organic vitamin C ascorbic acid that is used as a cofactor for the action of the hydroxylase enzymes. And in the end, eighth type disease is Menisky's disease, that is secondary to the deficiency of the copper required for the enzyme called as the lysyl oxidase enzyme. Lysyl oxidase enzyme required for the covalent cross-linking step. Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. This is the syndrome that is the group of the disease that is the inherited disorders. In this disease, Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, in this syndrome, there's a hyperextensibility of the skin occurs, and there's abnormal tissue fragility, and there's increased joint mobility. You can see in that lady, she can touch her thumb with her forearm, but we cannot do this. We cannot bend our thumb. We cannot touch it with our arm. So this is hyperextensibility of the joints that happens in this syndrome called as Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. You can see this is the hyperextensibility. Skin is stretchable. And there is a fragility of the skin is fragile. So this is called as the Ehlers-Danlos syndrome. Alport syndrome is a group of disorders that are X-linked autosomal disorders. That is, there is the defect of the type 4 collagen molecule that happens in the basement membrane of the renal glomeruli. Over there, it is defective type 4 collagen found in the basement membrane at the renal level that may lead to the hematuria and finally can cause the end stage renal disease. This is called the Alport syndrome. Epidermolysis bullosa, and this is the disease caused by the mutation of the collagen 7A1 type. A1 is actually alpha polypeptide chain, and collagen 7 type, this is the gene for the collagen 7 type. And in collagen 7 type, one alpha chain, LA1, is mutated, and this happens in the 7th collagen type. Okay, so you can see this is the 7th collagen type, and the defect is of the alpha 1 chain, polypeptide chain mutation is there, and the structure of the 7th collagen type is affected. There's effect of the basal lamina of the dermis. So as it is named behind the epidermolysis bullosa, as the name indicate, there is a blistering of the skin over the minor trauma, and there's the breaking of the skin and the blister formation in this disease. The next is the epidermolysis bullosa simplex, the mutation of the keratin 5 that happens in the epidermolysis bullosa simplex. This is the role of the vitamin C that we will discuss at the end. This is the vitamin C collagen synthesis role in the collagen synthesis. The role of vitamin C is very important to you. Now you know that vitamin C is required for the hydroxylation of the proline and lysine, and then they are hydroxylated to the hydroxyproline and hydroxylysine. Deficiency of the vitamin C causes disease called as the scurvy that leads to the bleeding gums. The bleeding gums are due to the deficiency of the collagen in the areas wherever there is the collagen is found. Vitamin C promotes the healthy immune system. It helps the wound healing. It maintains the blood vessel integrity and the connective tissue integrity. It aids the absorption of the iron. The daily requirement, the recommended daily allowance of the vitamin C is 60 milligram per day. Pathophysiology, vitamin C is functionally most relevant for the triple helix formation of the collagen. A vitamin C deficiency results in the impaired collagen synthesis. Proline and lysine hydroxylases are required for the post-synthesis. Post-synthetic modification of the procollagen are pro-alpha chain synthesis to the collagen. Okay, so for collagen, mature collagen synthesis, hydroxyproline and hydroxylysine are very necessary, and for their synthesis, vitamin C is required. Vitamin C is necessary, is required as a cofactor, is required as a coenzyme for these two enzymes, prolyl hydroxylase and lysyl hydroxylase. Vitamin C deficiency leads to the condition is called as scurvy, that is characterized by the weakness, anemia, bruising, and the bleeding gums and the loose teeth. So if you have any question, I have no time to answer you. You can ask me through.